Macmillan Audio presents The British Are Coming, Young Readers Edition, by Rick Atkinson. Read by Matt Haynes. One. The Court of King George III, 1773 through 1775. On the evening of December 16th, 1773, a few dozen American colonists, men with their faces darkened by lamp black or charcoal, descended with war whoops down Milk Street in Boston to board three merchant ships moored at Griffin's Wharf. Prying open the hatches, they used pulleys to lift from the holds hundreds of heavy chests containing 45 tons of tea. For 3 hours they smashed the lids and scooped the tea leaves into the harbor. Accomplices in small boats used rakes and oars to scatter the floating piles, and by morning, almost 10,000 pounds worth of soggy brown flakes drifted from the wharf to Castle Island and the Dorchester shore. "The devil is in these people," a British naval officer wrote after seeing the damage. But a local lawyer exulted, "This destruction of the tea," John Adams declared, "is so bold, so daring, so firm, intrepid, and inflexible." A silversmith named Paul Revere carried a detailed account of the event to New York and Philadelphia in the first of his famous gallops. "I am much hurt," King George III confessed in mid-January 1774, when news of this outrage reached him in London. As King of Great Britain since 1760, his realm also included the 13 American colonies. Sorrow soon yielded to anger. What should be done? Confusion and uncertainty plagued the government, which was beset with conflicting reports and opinions. Was this challenge to British authority widespread, or limited to a few scoundrels in New England? Was reconciliation possible? Friction between the colonies and the mother country had been building for almost a decade. Colonists resented being taxed by Britain without representation in Parliament, Britain's law-making body in London. In England, many thought of the colonists as spoiled, ungrateful children. However, some London merchants signed petitions urging caution for fear that the loss of American markets would cripple their businesses. The colonists bought up to 20% of British manufactured goods, but the market for certain commodities was much bigger. A quarter of British salt, a third of sugar, tin, and wool socks, half of copper utensils, glassware, and silk goods, and two-thirds to three-quarters of iron nails, boat ropes, and beaver hats. The king's heart hardened. Rejecting petitions and appeals from those pleading for moderation, he vowed in March 1774 to stop the present disorders. To British lawmakers in Parliament, which included the House of Commons and the House of Lords, he denounced a dangerous spirit of resistance in America among my deluded subjects. The king and his advisers believed that British wealth and status derived from its colonies. The erosion of authority in America would encourage rebellions in the other colonies of Canada, Ireland, the Caribbean, and India. With the empire broken up, an impoverished Great Britain, no longer great, would invite the scorn of Europe and exploitation by enemies in France, Spain, and elsewhere. Those piles of wet tea leaves foretold political and economic ruin. From late March through June 1774, Parliament adopted laws known collectively in Britain as the Coercive Acts, and later in America as the Intolerable Acts. The first was punitive. Boston's port must close until the cost of the ruined tea was paid to the East India Company, which traded goods, including the destroyed tea, with the colonies. The other laws tightened British control over Massachusetts. British troops would occupy Boston under a commander-in-chief who would also serve as the royal governor. In a separate session, Parliament approved expanding the boundaries of its Canadian territory to the west and south, to the rich territory between the Mississippi and Ohio rivers. Infuriated American colonists felt that they were being confined to the Atlantic coast. "The die is now cast," King George wrote. "The colonies must either submit or triumph. We must not retreat." 2. St. Stephen's Chapel, Palace of Westminster, London, January 1775. On January 19, 1775, the House of Commons reconvened in St. Stephen's Chapel after the Christmas holiday. With a thud, a clerk dropped 149 documents on a central table, announced that they were papers relating to the disturbances in North America, and in a somber tone began to read the titles of each. Royal Navy dispatches from American waters, seditious extracts from the Continental Congress, reports written by royal officials from New Hampshire to Georgia, official correspondence from London to colonial governors. Slouched on a bench was Lord Frederick North, a childhood friend of King George. He supervised the national finances as head of the Treasury Board. Steadfastly loyal to the king and skilled in debate, North was the principal defender of government policy in the Commons. In the past year, he had delivered more than 100 speeches relating to the American colony, most of them harsh. Now, he was fated to be a war minister, with his king's empire in the balance. He could talk tough, as in his claim that "America must fear you before they will love you," or his assurance to the Commons that 4 or 5 frigates could close Boston Harbor because "the militia of Boston are no match for the force of this country." Both Houses of Parliament, the House of Commons and the House of Lords, supported North's proposal to ask the king to declare Massachusetts in rebellion and to take all measures needed to bring the American rebels to heel. The next day, hundreds of members of both houses paraded to St. James's Palace for the king to hear their petition. "We find that a part of your majesty's subjects in the province of the Massachusetts Bay have proceeded so far to resist the authority of the supreme legislature that a rebellion at this time actually exists. We consider it as our indispensable duty humbly to beseech your majesty that you will take the most effectual measures to enforce due obedience to the laws and authority of the supreme legislature." King George replied, "You may depend on my taking the most speedy and effectual measures for enforcing due obedience to the laws. It is my ardent wish that this disposition may have a happy effect on the temper and conduct of my subjects in America." Events now moved swiftly. That very day, the king ordered several regiments in Ireland to prepare for foreign service. And so war stuffs were gathered to be loaded onto westbound ships, canteens, leather cartridge boxes, overcoats, tents, 5-ton wagons by the dozen, muskets by the hundreds, powder by the ton. And there was a run on New World maps. Troops tramped toward the ports. Each regiment was also permitted to take 60 women, 12 servants, and 86 tons of baggage. No one could foresee that the American War of Independence would last 3,059 days, or that the struggle would be marked by more than 1,300 actions, mostly small and bloody, with a few large and bloody, plus 241 naval engagements in a theater initially bounded by the Atlantic seaboard, the St. Lawrence and Mississippi rivers, and the Gulf of Mexico. The odds were heavily stacked against the Americans. No colonial rebellion had ever succeeded in casting off imperial shackles. 3. Boston, Massachusetts, March 6, 1775. In the 9 months since British warships had closed the port, warehouses stood vacant, shipyards idle, wharves deserted, shop shelves empty. Only a bountiful local crop of lambs and charity from other colonies kept Bostonians from hunger. Fish and flour from elsewhere in New England, rice from the Carolinas, rye from Baltimore, 1,000 bushels of wheat from Quebec, cash from Delaware and Montreal. Town selectmen launched projects to employ the unemployed, street paving, well digging, building a new brickyard. But gangs of idle sailors, longshoremen, rope makers, riggers, and carpenters could often be found loitering by the docks or in the town's 90 taverns. On Monday morning, March 6th, the gloomy place abruptly sprang to life. Hundreds and then thousands filled the streets to commemorate the bloody 1770 brawl between an unruly mob and British soldiers that had left 5 civilians dead in what was now known as the Boston Massacre. Dr. Joseph Warren, a prominent local physician, intended to deliver a speech titled "The Baleful Influence of Standing Armies in Time of Peace" in the Old South Meeting House. An uneasy murmur rose from the congregants. It was rumored that mass arrests were likely this morning, and that British officers had agreed that if the king was insulted, they would draw swords and slaughter the offenders. The murmur in Old South grew louder when several dozen red-coated officers clumped through the doorway and stood in the aisles. Rising to the pulpit, Dr. Warren invoked the long struggle to carve a country from the New England wilderness. He described Britain's recent efforts to assert authority over the country and the shootings 5 years before that had left "the stones bespattered with your father's brains." Then came the coercive axe, insult upon injury. "Our wish is that Britain and the colonies may, like the oak and the ivy, grow and increase in strength together," Warren said. "But if these pacific measures are ineffectual, and it appears that the only way to safety is through fields of blood, I know you will not turn your faces from your foes." The 6 weeks following Dr. Warren's speech were filled with dread suspense, as the Reverend William Emerson of Concord later wrote. Yet daily life plodded on. Goods smuggled or stockpiled before the port's closing could be found for a price, including candles for 5 shillings a pound in Faneuil Hall Market, along with blue dye and a few barrels of sugar. American preparations for war continued. Secret military cargo had arrived all winter, smuggled from Germany, the Netherlands, even London, the Simsbury Iron Works in Connecticut cast cannonballs. Women in Salem, Massachusetts, secretly cut and stitched 5,000 flannel powder cartridges for field guns. Farm carts hauled ammunition and powder kegs down country lanes to be hidden in attics or buried in new plowed furrows along with radish and onion seeds. In Concord, a militia colonel.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.